And I traveled all around Spain, and one of my things was to go to Granada and meet my friend who I met on my honeymoon, who was a gypsy man. He said one day, Leo, we're going to a christening, and I want you to come with me. The whole gypsy family came, and it was beautiful during the day. We had lunch and singing and playing. So they said, Leo, tonight there's going to be an amazing juerga for the girl that was christened. We park the car, we get out of the car, and one guy comes in my face and he goes, in Spanish, of course, he goes, where are you going? I said, oh, I'm just waiting for my friend. We're going inside for the juerga. He goes, no, you can't come in. You're white. You're payo. You can't come in.
A mí me metieron en un calabozo. A mí me metieron en lo más malo, que no podía
You can see the ferry from here, the one you came across.
Martin es mi maestro de guitarra. Anteriormente, yo había estudiado la guitarra clásica y después de algún tiempo me interesó aprender flamenco.
That's the ferry crossing down there between those two points.
Una tarde, Martin me dijo que su maestro de guitarra flamenca, David Phillips, acababa de morir.
Okay, I'll just show you a little bit of the music that I got from David Phillips. All these drawers is all David's music, and I've added some of mine to it, but most of it is David's. There's different Faruca, there's all Faruca here, and there's Guajiras, Alegrías.
En el flamenco existen varios ritmos que son regionales, y cada ritmo tiene su propia estructura musical.
Zapateado at the end. These are drawers of flamenco, and then there's quite a bit of classical music that David had as well. All the top layer there, that's all music written out either by me or David, like quite a bit of it is David's. Quite often it's difficult to tell what combination you're using of thumb fingers. So David, this is all David's writings. So that's David told me that's 40 years of composing and playing, what you see here. So I really appreciate getting that from him. He could have given it to a lot of people, but, you know, he decided to give it to me. And I'll never forget it. You know, you just do it like this. That's the first thing you do, so try that. Those three things.
Entre lecciones, Marty me contó anécdotas de David y de cómo su maestro vivió una vida muy influencial.
And David, I think that David could have done anything he wanted in the world, but he just absolutely loved music, and so he ended up, you know, trying to scrape out a living. But it's very tough for musicians in those days.
I am Patricia Eli. I came from a very large family of 11 children and grew up in Northern Ontario. I am the only one left of that large family, and I am David Phillips' aunt. Naomi, David's mother, met Wilson Phillips, and they were married and moved to Kirkland Lake. They had two children. They had Arden first and David second.
I'm Fred Roberts, an old-time friend of Dave Phillips. We went to high school together. I first met him at Central Tech in Toronto. He was actually one of the youngest people to ever get a license to operate an amateur radio station. He had to learn Morse code. He could do 30 or 40 words a minute. I used to go up to his place after school, and he used to spend all night at it, sort of thing.
That is the great famous Savikas. And Chascalis was another flamenco player, lived in Toronto for a while. And I was just telling that I introduced Dave to Savikas when he was a very young man. Savikas came here then about twice or three times. I'm only half of me when you're out there.
Cheers.
Come on. I'm imbalanced.
Yeah, we know that.
When I first met Ellie, I thought he was going to be this tall, imposing Viennese teacher, because I'd heard it, he had the strong Viennese accent. So I had an old-fashioned idea of him. And my father drove me over, and there was this little, like, rotund little guy in the rockeries pulling out weeds. And so we stopped, and I said, oh, is this the house of Ellie Cash? Never thinking that was Ellie. And he said, I am Ellie Gassner, welcome. Oh my God. I was like 13. It was when I had my first lesson.
I used to take lessons, and there was always somebody waiting to come in for the next lesson. It was like half-hour lessons. And Leona Boyd was always the next after me, or one before me, I don't remember exactly. And always there was one room where I used to go in before. You used to see Ellie, you used to hear people practicing vigorously, like...
This is a charango, by the way, that little guitar that's played in
South America.
In Mexico too, they play that. You can see that the head of the armadillo, his eyes.
And poor little thing. You see all the hair?
Yeah, it's got hair on it.
Red hair.
It's a beautiful sound, eh?
Mm-hmm. Eli Kastner, of course, you know, very well known. Classic guitarist, among other things, and I just know he's a wonderful guitarist and also a wonderful person himself. And he has done a lot for classic guitar. He's kind of the Segovia of Canada, you know, from what I've heard of many years, and also what I've seen on TV and so on, that he was as influential in Canada as Segovia was in Europe or Spain. And David is certainly his classical disciple.
I started to teach guitar in 1953-54, and he was, I think, my fifth student. I don't know how he heard about me, but he just was out of high school. He was racing cars. He had doctoring cars for stock races, and he developed this interest in guitar, and he learned very quickly classical guitar, you know, Bach, Debussy, and so on. It took him very little time to learn, and he became really addicted to this. And he stopped all other activities. He stopped working, he stopped going to any kind of school, and decided to become a guitarist.
He practiced, and not playing tunes or anything, it was scales, and he was practicing and drive you crazy with these. He didn't want to talk, he wanted to play this guitar.
At the beginning, he was amazing. He was absolutely amazing. He studied these things. He learned it very, very quickly. He developed very quickly, very good hand. And he was sight reading things. I mean, it was amazing. I was astonished. But it didn't last long, you see. As I told you, he suddenly...
Well, he found his niche with flamenco.
No, but that, before that, he gave up everything else. He lost interest in something, he lost inspiration. He walked on along the lake for endless hours. And then I showed him some flamenco, and that's when he got the spark, when he got lit up again. And that's when he decided to go and study flamenco.
Thank you.
He stayed there for some time, I think 2 or 3 years, and studied with some of the then available flamenco, doing just that, like simply, I mean, they don't, see, they can't analyze it or say that's what we're supposed to do, because they do everything they do entirely instinctively.
Me llamo José Luis Valle Fajardo, alias El Chocale. Yo soy gitano y vengo de una familia gitana. Me crié en la cueva de mis abuelos. Tenía una mano así de guitarrista de aquella, decía, uff, qué alegría, no fui a menos.
These guys studied this when they were little kids. They learned to dance first. And they have all the compass, the number of beats. Very authentic if you play written out flamenco. It doesn't sound like flamenco. Even if it's brilliantly played, it doesn't sound like flamenco. Flamenco is a much more, it's a totally instinctive.
British accent and being very proper.
In the early days, certainly she could be very intimidating because there was a correct way to do things and there was a not so correct way. So intent on getting people to understand flamenco definitely and the source of flamenco as a dancer, where it's coming from, that you're not so involved with the aesthetic image of what you're doing. It's much more about it's starting here and you have, it's that individual expression.
Paula, so many of us have continued and she has generated so many wonderful artistic seeds. I do believe that Paula opened up the doors for funding for Spanish dance in Canada.
She even won the Jacqueline Lemieux Award in 1987, which is a huge dance award, and that comes with being in the field for your whole lifetime.
She phoned me. She came to Toronto. It's an English woman. She wanted actually me to do her company. And I didn't play flamenco. But I knew of Dave, who has just come back from Spain. And that clicked.
I was actually Dave's best man at his wedding. They moved into an old house on Isabella Street.
Shows all around the country, of course. This one time they played, and Trudeau was there, and he was the only one. David said he was the only one who knew when to ole at the right time. During the performance. And after the performance, he came backstage to meet the performers, and he particularly pointed out David and asked him what part of Spain he had come from.
Dave and Paula gave a whole added spice and dimension to the music scene in Toronto in the 60s, 70s, and I know he had many, many students, and Paula had a whole dance school, so they were very significant. They played a major role in Toronto at that time, yeah.
En Yorkville solía haber muchos hippies, mucha gente, porque había la guerra de Vietnam entonces, y había principalmente mucha juventud. Me acuerdo que venían estas furgonetas de los Volkswagen, que eran los únicos, el único van que había era el Volkswagen. Y entre todo ese ambiente que había en Yorkville, que había mucha gente, escuché una guitarra flamenca, y allí había flamenco, que era en el 71, que se llama hoy Joshua Restor. Y ahí fue donde conocí a muchos de mis amigos, y conocí a Dave y a Paula, y ahí es donde iban todos los flamencos aquí en Toronto.
Pepe Perez, I met at the coffee shop. He used to come with a bunch of friends, Spanish friends, who used to love flamenco. He loved to play the guitar, and he was my first teacher of flamenco guitar. Showed me a few little things, and especially the rhythms. The rhythms were very important, more than any finger work that you can do was the rhythm.
Thank you.
ganas de agarrar el teléfono y llamar, dice, pero David no está aquí más, ¿no? Porque hablábamos siempre, y siempre, un 70% siempre de música, de flamenco. Cuando había conciertos aquí en Toronto, venía algún flamenco, pues éramos los primeros que íbamos a verlo. Cuando Paco venía aquí, éramos los primeros que íbamos por Paco, a estar al lado de él, hablando de flamenco. Siempre era hablando de flamenco. Aquí en Toronto, David ha sido el número uno. Ha sido el que más influencia ha tenido en el flamenco. Y eso no, que sea del norte o de Ontario, eso no tiene nada que ver, porque el mejor guitarrista del mundo que ha dado la historia no es gitano, que es Paco Lucía. Vicente Amigo no es gitano.
I met Pepe actually just after I met David. We used to go down to Improvo, which Juan Garcia ran.
Yo abrí el Embrujo Flamenco en el 72 y lo tuve durante 12 años. Y lo pasaban bien porque era una cosa después de horas y entonces la gente, pues cuando venía de los shows, de otros shows, entonces venía allí a cantar y tomarse un cafelito y estaba muy, muy alegre, muy alegre.
Era el punto, digamos, bohemio, ¿no? Donde entrabas y podías cantar. Había siempre una guitarra por ahí, ¿no? Déjame la guitarra, Juan, o danos un vinito aquí o una cerveza, ¿ves? Pues no sé, siempre que había alguien, siempre entraba alguien, flamenco.
There was something very interesting about El Brujo in that there was a certain hour at night where everything just very changed, and I think it was when the doors were locked and the cognac and alcohol was served in coffee cups and not in wine glasses anymore.
Era un bar normal, no era nada, digamos, de locura, pero era una locura para la locura de los músicos, porque llegabas y ahí tu cervecita, pues tu vinito, tus morcillas, tu, ¿sabes? Te digo, todo ese tipo de ambiente en español, pues que uno quiere estar allí. Y aquí no lo encuentras, pues entonces vas a un rinconcito pues, y ahí está.
Yo conocí a David Phillips a los 3 o 4 meses de llegar a Canadá, porque ellos tenían un estudio en Isabella Street. Iba mucho, que hacían juergas los sábados, se reunían y bailaban y todo eso, y tocaban la guitarra, y iba mucho aficionado. Y de allí, pues, a mí me dio también la esa de aprender flamenco. Como español y andaluz, pues siempre ha gustado el flamenco, pero nunca hasta que salí de mi país reconocí mi cultura más, ¿sabes? Y entonces yo empecé con David. David Philly a tomar clases de flamenco. Una anécdota, cuando yo empecé a tomar clases con David, le pregunté, David, ¿cómo se lleva la guitarra? ¿Con la parte estrecha, si para adelante o para atrás? Y claro, él se rió, ¿no? Dice, pues la guitarra se lleva así, con la parte más estrecha, ¿no? Y yo, claro, yo inocentemente, pero se lo pregunté porque él lo sabía, yo no.
Initially started playing guitar there. I never really purposely said that I'm going to be a guitarist. I just loved the instrument and just fell in love with that kind of music. And that's the guitar style I wanted to play.
I was born born here in Canada, in Montreal. Started playing guitar when I was about 12, 13, and my idol back then was Jimi Hendrix. Afterwards, when I heard Paco de Lucía, I changed idols pretty fast, and then it was just, you know, trying to learn everything about, you know, flamenco and what those guys are doing on the guitar, because for me, that's what the guitar was invented for.
I was sent to David Phillips through Alan Torok. I was studying with him initially when I first discovered a teacher here in Canada. And he said, you have to take classes with this Dave Phillip guy.
When I arrived here to look for some anything, you know, related to flamenco, I saw his magazine at the time when he was in Guitar Canada. I met David, and then afterwards I decided to move out here in Toronto because of that.
When I first saw him, all I could see that he's a flamenco guitarist. He was an authentic flamenco guitarist, and he knew a hell of a lot. That's what I first, because for me, I'm from Trinidad. There's the, what does a Spanish guy look like to me? You know what I mean? He looks, to me, for all intents and purposes, he looks Spanish.
It's such a clear and vivid memory in my head of my first lesson with David. At the time, I was listening to a lot of Sabicas and Paco Peña, and he could play all of that and sound just like the record. And so it was pretty intimidating and inspiring at the same time.
I remember I was playing a farruca from a book written down, and I think I was playing it pretty well. Anyway, I asked Dave, the maestro, to give me a lesson on it. So he sat down and he played it through. Well, let me tell you, it was a different piece. It was music. And he still followed the music, but the way he played it,
yeah,
and the accentuation of certain things.
He was very generous to the point where he would suggest other teachers to take classes from while they were in town, like Triscales.
When I met him, actually, he had Triscales in the studio with him. And that was interesting because I didn't know who Triscales was until, you know, now looking back on it, I was quite amazed that, you know, I'd met Triscales here first when he was living here.
Tuve la gran satisfacción de conocer a David Phillips como persona y como guitarrista y trabajamos juntos en varias ocasiones. Él fue uno de los pioneros que abrió la puerta, digamos, al flamenco, o lo introdujo aquí, ¿no? Les dejó una huella muy grande aquí. Creo que lo que mejor hizo y lo que mejor ha dejado hecho fue como maestro, como profesor de guitarra.
None of us would be here if it wasn't for him. I mean, we won't have the knowledge we have today if it wasn't for him. There's no way. I mean, he set the standard originally.
Y después de pues ya han venido otras gentes, pero vamos, que hay que darle su un poco de énfasis, un poco de título a las personas que abren la puerta para que los demás vengamos y lo continuemos, ¿no? De una manera o de otra.
He didn't think of himself only. He thought about the next generation of guitarists coming out of there. He cared about the art form enough that he really did try to give as much as he can. I think that's his legacy, and I think he will always be remembered for doing that.
Further along,
he will show me things for dance accompaniment, which was what his purpose was, to show me the other end of the flamenco guitar, which is the accompaniment style.
I started with classes. David had me start with the classes to get used to accompaniment of dance.
First, David used to sit in the classes with us and play, and so we can learn from him. And then once he felt that we can do it, we kind of, the guitarists at the time that were there, including myself, would play for those classes.
What that taught me, and others, I'm sure, was the importance of the relationship between guitarist and dancer.
First started to perform live for dance, and that was nice under his tutelage, and it was great. I learned a lot from that, and I think that's why I enjoy company dance so much now, because of that.
Something that I will always remember about David is that when he would accompany you, whether it was in class or in a concert situation or a show, if you made tons of mistakes, and I mean really messed up badly, David always made you look good. As long as you kept your cool and kept dancing and kept looking like you knew what you were doing, David knew how to find you.
He would and cover.
He would cover for you, and that's something special that not too many guitarists are willing to do.
David was always a wonderful soul. Always, always, always. Very gentle, very quiet.
I just remember being asked to go in and practice because Paula was putting me in the company, and I had to learn all this repertoire, and I had to go in and rehearse, and I was on my own, and once in a while David would come in and ask if I was doing okay, and I was like, I have no idea what I'm doing, I can't remember anything, so I don't know what to rehearse, and he would, you know, help me out. He'd take out the guitar and go through a few things.
For the years I've known David, I've never heard him say anything negative to any of the dancers that he ever accompanied.
No, he's always extremely supportive and very generous.
Exactly, very generous,
very generous.
Yeah. And a very sensitive person. I can remember actually going and listening to David play, because he used to play at restaurants like at the Sutton Place.
Thank you. I remember I used to go over to the house, and Dave, I say, he was trying to teach me some of the techniques a bit, and we would, you know, be working on different ideas that I liked, and he would show me certain rhythms, and then his crazy cat, El Gato Loco, would come running around, and I always wanted a cat, so I was always kind of jealous. Hey, Dave's got this cat with great personality that would be leaping up and down, and he was amazing.
Wait a minute. Where does it say cat gets in the picture? Can we finish?
I hope you got lots of film on you.
Hey, excuse me. Isn't this interesting up here?
And as I started traveling and giving concerts and making records, I thought it would be really nice to do an arrangement of Granada. I think that's the one he did first for me. I was in Havana, I opened up this big international guitar festival, and Pietro Do had sent one of my albums, in those days they were albums, to Fidel Castro, and suddenly I had a private concert for him. I thought, oh my goodness. So I remember playing him Gran Jota de Concierto, and he loved it and was tapping his foot along. One day I got a call from somebody from Montreal, and he said, my father is dying, he's on his last few days, and his dying wish is to hear you play Malaguena. Are you coming to Montreal anytime? And I said, no, I'm sorry, I'm in California, there's no way. But I said, I'll play it to him over the phone. So the whole family was gathered around, and I played Malaguena on the phone, and I think it was the next day the man died. His whole family sent me such beautiful letters. And what was interesting, they filmed him listening to me, and then I didn't know they could do it. Then they emailed me the film. That was the first time I ever got a little film emailed to me through the internet. So I watched this man on I guess his deathbed in the hospital listening to me, and there were tears rolling down his eyes. That was his lifetime wish, to have heard me play that. So that was a gift, and I can't thank Dave enough, because that was a piece that obviously moved this man and was able to touch him in his last moments on the earth. So Dave really did have he gave me a tremendous gift with these pieces.
Well-worn pieces. Sorry, Dave's name is a little, little faded there.
On my steel string guitars especially, I do a lot of inlay work, and I'm known for sort of pushing the envelope of what's done. I really just see it as an art form. It's not decoration on the guitar. The neck to me is a canvas. Whatever the theme or the story is I'm portraying, like any other artist, I use models, I come up with a sketch, and then I just turn it into stone and shell and engraving and do it on an instrument. And I needed a couple of models. So David came over and he modeled for an inlay that's, it's been published in a book. He was modeling in his underwear and a jacket on, you know, playing a certain role on an inlay that I did. And another friend of his who also played a role. That was really fun. I wish I got to use him again, and I would have if he was still around, because he has an interesting face. And he was very good as a model. He knew how to take a pose and sit still. I had known David for some time because he was part of the music scene here, whether he was doing arrangements for classical players or flamenco music or playing guitar for the Paul Moreno Dance Company, who I'd seen perform, so I'd seen him on stage. So we all kind of knew each other in the same communities, but it was really over talking guitars that he said to me, you know, why don't you try and make a flamenco guitar? I'd been making classical and steel string guitars, but never tried a flamenco, even though I loved the music. And what he did was send guitars my way every time he came near them. When a player came into his studio, for whatever reason, they were teaching, they were learning, you know, he was buying and selling guitars. If he got an interesting guitar, he'd call me up and I'd dash over to his studio to have a look at it, talk to him about it, play it, look inside with mirrors, take measurements. And he'd send me home with books to read just to get the feeling, the mood of where people were coming from. And it really did help give a kind of global understanding of where flamenco players' mental position is and what they're going to be looking for. This one's almost 20 years old, and it's what they call a negro flamenco, meaning dark wood on the back and sides, and it's rosewood instead of the traditional cypress. What sets that apart from a classical guitar, even though these are nylon strings, like classical, it's much lighter constructed, and that's largely because the action, the height of the strings, away from the top and the neck are much lower. And the closer you get to parallel to the soundboard, the tension drops off. Also, you need to be close to the top for the percussive playing techniques. If you're too far away, the way a classical guitar is built, you'd do the technique and you'd miss the top. You wouldn't be able to play it. In addition to the fact that all of the tensions, the way your right hand feels it in this area, would feel different if the bridge was higher and the angle of the strings coming up to them was more extreme. And yeah, I'm seeing lots of nail marks on this one, which is good. It means it's being played. I don't like it when I see old guitars of mine and they're perfect. My first thought is, what's the matter? Don't they like it? The neck itself is a Spanish cedar, cedrela, which is actually more like a lightweight mahogany, but because of the name cedrela, it's called Spanish cedar in English. And that's traditional wood, and the body is bound in ebony, and we have rosewood on the back and sides.
This is actually Alaskan. I brought this one up because this was the first guitar I got, the first flamenco guitar I got from David. It's sort of my beat-up one. This is a guitar I learned flamenco on.
And the music, where it was coming from, which led me to better try and deliver what was going to be needed out of this wooden box and how to set it up for flamenco players. So I have him to thank.
Max, este es el estuche de... de nuestro Amigo, como verás, tiene aquí todavía el nombre de él, David Phillips. Afortunadamente, la guitarra no está en este momento aquí, porque la guitarra la mandé yo para España. Tenía pensado dejarla allí y guardarla como recuerdo, ¿no?
I even remember his own guitar, which looked like something out of a Frankenstein movie.
David la quería mucho. Ha estado tocando con ella muchísimos años, prácticamente toda su carrera. Y él me decía a mí muchas veces, yo me voy a la tumba, yo me muero con esta guitarra.
He told me one day he was about to do a gig and he's packing up his station wagon, I believe it was a station wagon. And he packed everything was packed, but he forgot his guitar outside. He left it outside, but behind the car.
We got in the car and he backed up and we felt a bump. And he says, did that sound like a Ramirez to you?
You know, it was loading the trunk and it was still in the driveway and he didn't realize and couldn't see out the back window. So he backed the car over it.
He ran over his own guitar. It was toothpicks.
And obviously it was destroyed.
And he told me he remembers going to somebody to repair it. This was before he and I knew each other. And he brought all the bits in a paper bag and said, here's my baby, you know? And they did put it together, but the sides, the back, there's all these joints where things were patched to stick together.
And it turns out that the guitar still sounds very sweet. And that's the guitar that he decided to stay with for the rest of his life, so to speak.
And of course, very flamenco, he said it sounded so much better after that because the guitar had suffered, you know. That was one of the first times I heard that. But he was playing it right to his dying day. Story that David told me, you can laugh afterwards, but it, at the moment it'd be pretty tragic, is he developed psoriasis between the nail and the skin. So the nails, they lose adhesion because they're not stuck to anything. Psoriasis would be like a flakiness in the skin, so they'd come off. And he told me about one time it happened in the middle of performance in a club when one of his nails popped right off, spun around and landed right in the drink of somebody who was sitting at a table near the stage, you know? And this sudden shock by both of them as he looks down and realizes he has one less nail than he did just a moment ago. Yeah. It meant that for months at a time, he could teach, but he couldn't perform until the nails would grow back in and he would have this small window of time when they would adhere strong enough to pluck the strings until the psoriasis acted up again and problems would happen again.
As it was getting worse, I left Toronto, I moved to Picton, I got married and had children and so on. And I saw less and less of David. And then I heard that he and Paula broke up, and I heard that he wasn't teaching any longer. Wasn't playing for Paula anymore, and I don't know exactly what happened after that, but he ran into very hard times.
Later on in life, I joined OCA, Ontario College of Art, where I just wanted to go back to my drawing and painting studies. I wanted to learn more. One day, I'm getting ready my easel and my painting stuff and getting ready to paint, I'm waiting for the model. Who comes in? David. And I look, I go, David? He goes, hi, Leo. So what are you doing? He says, I'm modeling. I'm your model today.
I hadn't been in touch with him for a few years at that point, so I started calling him up and talking a little bit with him, chatting with him a little bit over the phone.
One Christmas, I phoned him to see how he's doing, and he said, for the first time, he says, not so good. And he told me what happened.
I felt bad about what was happening to him, how sick he was, because his mother and his father both were alcoholics and had quite a rough time too. So I knew that it wasn't all David's fault that he was alcoholic.
Looked awful the last few years that of his life. He was really down, like very, very down. You know, he wasn't performing anymore the way he used to. He lost interest in performing. He didn't have any more money, so that was his last choice, was to start modeling and to make some money. After that, I heard he was gone, and it was a really sad story, you know, to see him end up just gone.
Together for the last 6 years of his life. I moved in with him in this apartment, and I inherited the apartment after he died. Well, we met in the autumn of 96 at Pilot Tavern, and a place where both of us had been going for, you know, a few years. And we got talking because his cat had died not too long before. And I'm a great cat lover, and he was showing pictures of his cat to another friend, and I asked if I could see them. And so we got talking about cats, and I guess we got talking about music very quickly after that. We both had a great love of music and very eclectic tastes in music. And of course, I was very intrigued that he played flamenco. He was very interested in the fact that I collected old radios from the 50s. He got a kick out of the fact that I taught myself Morse code when I was about 11, just for the fun of it. I was very interested that he'd been a ham radio operator as a teenager, and in fact was the youngest ham operator in Canada.
David phoned me up one day and offered to give me his music, and I didn't know why. I said, I have to get rid of all my music and so on. So Anyways, I said, well, sure, you know, I'd love to have your music. And so I met him in Toronto, and he gave me all his music, but he didn't tell me that he was ill at that point. He didn't look well. His face was kind of yellowish and so on. But he didn't tell me he was ill or anything. He just said, I just would like you to have my music. It's time for me to, I'm now starting a new stage in my life. I think those were his words. And that's actually the last time I saw David.
I didn't realize that he was ill until he was very ill and on his last legs that he called me up one night. And he was interested in pictures of the car racing. I was shocked when he told me that he knew he was dying and he didn't know how much longer he had.
David had stopped drinking for a number of years, but started again before we met. And he had always said to me, I'm going to do whatever I'm going to do until the end. And that was his, you know, way of letting me know, no ultimatums, don't make me try and change. And I didn't. I knew better than to do that because it backfires. And he did quit again when he began to get ill. And the thing is, we didn't realize that it wasn't going to be in time.
I went and spent a day practically with David. He was in bed at that time. However, a friend of his took pictures of the two of us there. I've never seen them, so I don't know how they turned out. He was extremely happy that I had gone to see him when he was ill. And after all, I guess I was the only one left of the family at that point.
Ahora, cuando el pobre ya estaba muy en las últimas, que estaba bastante mal, y me decía siempre, tócame algo, toca por alegrías, toca por lo que tú quieras. Y eso ha sido la vida de nuestro amigo, que incluso en los últimos días pues llevaba el flamenco adentro, porque siempre con dolor y con todo, pero la música la llevaba adentro. Siempre le gustaba escuchar flamenco.
Yo sabía que estaba mal y había hablado algunas veces con él. Y fui, me parece que fueron dos o tres veces al hospital a verlo. Y la última vez que estuve a verlo, yo me iba a España de vacaciones. Entonces me preguntó, ¿cuándo vas a volver? Digo, pues estaré 6-7 meses. Y él, pues claro, me dijo, dice, no creo que te vea otra vez. ¿Sabe?
I have a very strong feeling that it is an honor to be present at someone's death. I remember closing his eyes after he died, and just staying there for a while, and then I noticed the time, and it was exactly 2:45 in the morning, and I said that he would have got a laugh out of it because it was the exact moment he had to get the drinks off the table in the bar, so he would have got a laugh out of that.
Thank you.
before David died. He mentioned that he'd like his ashes to be spread in the lake. I was very sorry when I heard that he had died, and I asked for the ashes because I was going up to Haileybury that summer, and I could take the ashes and carry out his wishes. But I was told, no, I wasn't to have the ashes. This friend of his said that she was going to look after that. And I had never heard as to whether she did or not.
We're going to be listening to one more piece by David Phillips, the Faluca. Please bear with me. The quality of sound is not nearly as good as of the other things we just heard, but it's a beautiful interpretation, so please do stay with us.